everybody in from the lobby if you're still making your way in. Come in and find your seat. I'd also like to invite my friend Maria Carroll on up to the stage.
I just want to explain something because some people are asking me why Taylor Andrew is calling you Maria Carol. My full name is Maria Carolina. And my Brazilian friends, my family in Brazil, they call me Carol. So some people from church find out about that. And now they want to try to change that and start calling me as my family in Brazil call me. So that's why he's trying to change that and call me Carol. But you're free to call me whatever you want. Carol or Maria. Yes, I'm going to answer you. But it's so good to have you guys here this morning. And yeah, it's a good place and good time for me in God's presence. So before we go to worship, I want to invite you to pray with me if you can stand up. And have a moment of prayer before we go to worship Lord this morning. And put your life, put your heart before the Lord. The Bible says that where the Spirit of God is, there is freedom. And the Spirit of God is here today. And in this place, we have freedom. We have freedom to dance. We have freedom to sing. We have freedom to worship. And that's why God invited us to live in this freedom and really receive His presence. So let's pray. Father, we are so thankful. We are so thankful to be here this morning. Holy Spirit, we are here and we are here to worship you. Father, you are welcome. You are welcome to pour out your Spirit over our lives this morning. Holy Spirit, make a room in this place and make a room in ourselves and our hearts and our mind that we can may see you this morning. Move inside of us, but also move in this place. Father, we surrender our hearts before you. We surrender our minds. We surrender our problems. We surrender everything that is going on inside of us right now. And Holy Spirit, would you please bring the peace of the Lord over our heart, that we are here to worship the Lord, and when we worship Him, He takes care of us and our family. So, Father, you are welcome here, and we want to worship and praise you this morning. So, come, Holy Spirit, and fill this place. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill our lives. And we pray all this in your powerful name, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
They're gonna lead us in hand motions. Kids in the room, kids at heart, join in. Let's worship.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love comes, He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You freed every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom. So Savior, the name lifted high, oh God, you have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great. I know you will do it again, for your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. Done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus.
Power is flowing through my veins.
Father, Son, and Spirit, magnificent Trinity.
Well, dear Heavenly Father and closest friend, God, I just pray this morning that whatever is going on in our hearts and our minds, Lord, that we would just acknowledge that before you and we'd give it to you as a gift that you truly desire to know us intimately, deeply, and everything that we've got going on, Lord. We just give that to you and we are reminded and we are refocused, Lord, within you is a magnificent trinity of life, of family, of a feeling at home, of relationship. Lord, I just thank you that you exist in constant communion within yourself and that you extend it to us. May we just taste that today in the way that our soul deeply needs so that we can continually be a gift to the people that are around us. Lord, we thank you, we love you, we honor you this morning. Come, Holy Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, you guys can have a seat. We are going to continue in worship through the giving of offerings and tithes. And I just want to share with you guys the thing that often comes to my mind at this part of service when we have the opportunity to practice generosity. And that is Red Lobster cheesy biscuits. Anyone else? Red Lobster biscuits? Wow, a lot of people. Think of that. During, or are you just like, I like Red Lobster biscuits. I didn't know that you're asking me that question. Well, that's what comes to my mind when it comes to this part of service, because I always think back to the opportunity when I was in college ministry. I got to meet with a spiritual mentor of mine, and one of the first times he ever took me out to lunch was to Red Lobster because I asked for it. He probably was expecting for like Chipotle or Wawa, and I was like, Red Lobster sounds good. But he took me to Red Lobster, and he gave me whatever I wanted. I stuffed my face with those cheesy biscuits, and it was that meeting that he talked to me about walking with Jesus more in my life, and it just changed the trajectory of my life, of being in the church and being a part of the kingdom. And when I think about that meetup, I think about the fact that he was in ministry and people gave sacrificially, financially, so that he could pay for that meal that I got to have with him. So every time we give you an invitation to practice generosity here at this church through the giving of your tithes and offering, it's sowing a seed for the sake of the kingdom expanding and impact happening in ways that sometimes we don't fully see, but God is faithful and true to do. So there are a couple ways on the screen that you can do that, and also in your bulletin that you should have gotten as you walked in. We just invite you, if you feel so led to do that with us, a part of this family, to do that as you feel led. And with that, I'm also going to shout out the kids in the room. I see some kids. Kids, what's up? What's up? It is your time to head to the loft with the kids ministry team. But make sure you check with your parents first before you head out. I see some parents nodding. Yes, you may go. You are released. But hey, you give us a great example of childlike faith. I see them running. I see them pumped up. Man, I want to see the adults showing up to Vessel like that in the morning. You know what I mean? Come on. That's a good example. But hey, also, if you are new here or you're new-ish, you've been coming for a little bit, I just want you to point you to the serve table, the first time table. We got some cookies for you. Can we make some noise for cookies? Come on. Come on. Come on. And if you feel so led, you've been here a long time, you're like, I'm new. Just remember, lying's a sin. Don't do that. But hey, we can work around that. We can get you some cookies too. But we're going to transition in this time of worship through a time of community greeting, getting some more coffee. If you feel led to give, do that as well, or just stop by the new newest table, and we'll come back in a couple minutes just to share a little bit more about what God's doing in and through the life of the church. Let's do that.
I love the loud noise of community in here, but if you could start making your way back to your seats, that would be awesome. And Chris and I are going to share a couple things going on in the life of the church this week. And it's a really slow week for Chris, so I'm really glad I get to be up here. Chris getting married this week.
Come on, come on, come on.
Outstanding. So
I got my little cruise medallion I'm wearing, you know what I mean? Just trying to show it off, you know, April 30th.
That's very good. Good. All right. Am I first? I think, oh, I am think first. So, yeah. No, you're first. Look.
Oh, yeah, I am. Hey, I have a slow week, right?
Yeah.
Hey, I want to give a shout-out to all my college students. Any college students? Come on. Let's go. Let's go. Hey. Yeah, I didn't pay him to say that at all. Devin, thank you. Your Venmo will get in later. But if you are a college student or you know a college student, this Tuesday we have a special event. We have an extended study day back at the Epicenter. So we're going to be reorganizing the room. We're going to have snacks throughout the whole day, coffee. If you need to print something, you can print something. I'll see if Carol can come by for just an intercessory prayer team if you're going through it. We'll have everything ready for you and available. And also at 7:30, we're going to stop from all the study. Take a small break. We're going to have pancakes for you guys. And also, I think there are going to be some puppies coming by. Some puppies, so a little bit of emotional support animals. I told a student that earlier this week that we're going to have dogs. And she looked at me thinking that I was, like, messing with her. Like, oh, huh. I was like, no, we actually are. And she was like, tears. So I think that's needed. So make sure you check that out. And if you have a college student, you know a college student, just point them our way. We love for you guys to come and join us on that.
Awesome. Well, I don't know how many of you went outside the past few days, but it kind of feels like summer has joined us and probably not going anywhere till like December. So for children's ministry, which I head up, that means VBS is coming. Yes.
That's right. That's right. That's
and
right.
For Megan. And Megan gets very excited about VBS, and so do I. And so do the kids. We have almost 300 kids signed up, which is awesome. But that means we need some help. We can't just set 300 kids loose in this building and hope for the best. So you can look on the screen. You might think to yourself, that's just dots. That's no big deal. No problem. But when those dots turn into people, we need adult volunteers to make sure our kids are safe, to make sure they're well cared for, to make sure they go where they're supposed to make sure they don't follow a sandhill crane into the woods. So
don't want that.
We do definitely need some more adult volunteers. But I want to frame it this way because I think this is really important. We do need you. I wouldn't be up here if we didn't. But two things, two challenges. Oh, I should tell you the dates and stuff, but you can see me at the table afterwards out front. It's the first week of June, June 3 to 7th, and it's 9 to noon. So it's not a huge time commitment. So that being said, two things. One, there's something about watching kids and being a part of kids start to grab a hold of their own faith, maybe for the first time or maybe a reignition of that, that works on our soul in profound ways. And so if you need a little jolt of energy in your walk with Jesus, there will be plenty of energy here. But I think it will speak to your soul. One. And two, I think if you look back on your faith journey, I know it's true of me, Chris shares about this a lot, there are always adults that aren't your parents that tend to feature prominently in sending you towards Jesus. And my challenge to you would be, if you have that week and can give it, you can be that adult for some of these kids. And so, if you have questions, whatever, I will be at the table with the pretty balloons out front. Anyone that knows me knows I didn't do those. That was Miss April. But I'll be out there to chat with you after service. Please come by and say hi, and I'll be happy to give you a card or make you fill out some information.
Yeah, I just want to also stand in agreement with Jesse that if you ever see anything that is nice at this church that draws you in or conveys something clearly in an interesting way, our hands were not on that.
Not one bit.
We sent something to Eli and we're like, hey, we have this. And he made it look like 1,000 times better.
Like
so
that.
Bless him. Like that. Yeah, honestly, I want a graphic that shows every prodigal student that's going to be coming to study today and how many dogs we need so we can get through
there
that event. Hey, the next thing I just want to announce on Wednesday nights from 6:45 6:45 to 7:45 for the next about 4 weeks. We're having a prayer set time, an hour of guided prayer through the scriptures. We just want to plug that to you guys to come and join it. It is a sacred and beautiful space. I've heard some amazing testimonies already come from that experience. So if you are new to prayer, been walking in prayer, you feel nervous about prayer, it's the spot for you to go. I just want to encourage you to check that out. There's never been a time that I've gone to prayer and I've regretted it. It's like going to the gym. Sometimes you got to hype yourself up. And if you go, when you look back, you're like, man, I'm glad I went. So please check that out on Wednesday nights from 6:45 to 7:45.
All right. Well, enough of us two knuckleheads. I want to invite my dear friend Scott Davis up to read the scripture for us today.
Come on, Scott. My man. My man. Well, the claps ended. It's okay, but you got time. Yeah, there we go. Sorry. Listen, I wasn't calling the crew out.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Like they said, my name's Scott. I'm going to read the scripture for today. So if you can, please rise for the reading of our scripture today. Today's scripture comes from Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. These words are true and can be trusted.
Amen. You can have a seat if you're not already. All right. Well, good morning. My name is Taylor. I'm one of the pastors here at Carillon and the pastor here at Vessel. Grateful to have you with us on the second week of this series. It's called Everything That Hinders. And as you probably heard from the scripture that Scott just read, it's pulled from these opening lines of Hebrews chapter 12, which is really the writer of Hebrews is addressing people who are trying to follow Jesus almost as like long distance runners, as these athletes. And it's really kind of this coaching call of being like, all right, everything that's hindering you in your pursuit of him, as you're running after Jesus, throw it all off. Everything that hinders, the sin that so easily entangles your feet, like get rid of it so that you can pursue Jesus and fix your eyes on him. And so each week of this series, we're going to be talking about something that just hinders us in our pursuit of Jesus and everything that he has for us. And so in the future weeks, we're going to talk about things like digital media and phones, unforgiveness and brokenness in relationships, impatience. And today, we're going to jump into one that I think is one of the most foundational of all of them. And so as we do jump in, would you join me in just a word of prayer as we kind of ready our hearts to receive what God has for us today? God, we come to you just with open hearts, God, and with as much attention in our minds as we can give you now, asking that you would speak. Because, Lord, what any of us need is not more words from my mouth or more ideas from my mind. God, the kind of words that bring life are the words from your mouth. And so, God, would you speak today specifically to each and every single person who has made the time to show up today or to listen in online. Speak to them, Holy Spirit, in an exact way that they need to hear. Now I want to invite you to take a few moments in the quietness of your own heart and mind and ask God to do that as well. They don't have to be fancy or spiritual words. Just ask God if he would speak to you today. And now would you pray for somebody else here in this room, somebody else in the community that like God would speak to them today as they listen as well. God, we give you our ears, we give you our attention. We pray and ask that you would give us your heart and move our feet so that we can be your church. We ask this in your name. Amen. All right, so how many of y'all are fans of those, like, kind of create your own bowl, build your own meal kind of a places? Anyone? Yeah. Hands up. Anyone like, no, this is too overwhelming. Just give me a menu and tell me what I want. Anyone? Okay. Oh, wow, really? I thought there'd be, no, everyone likes these places. Okay, so I think that these places are wonderful because there's, like, all the options in the world. And I also think that these places are terrible because there's all of these different options, and a lot of times the options don't always fit together. Do you know what I'm talking about? Like, you might, someone said bolé. Yeah, you're gonna show up and you're gonna be like, man, you know, that Mexican chicken looks really good. But I also really want Parmesan cheese, because who doesn't want Parmesan cheese, like, all the time? Sorry, that's just me. You're like, oh, maybe I also want pickled onions, and also this ginger sauce looks really good, you know, and then you get it all in the same bowl, and you're like, oh, mmm, like, those were all really great, but maybe not in the same place, you know, or you go to Menchie's, you're getting some froyo, and you're like, I want chocolate. And then you're like, oh, but also lemon sorbet and also caramel sauce. Let's put it all together, you know? And all of these things, which you like want all of them, they're all fine in their own bowls, like really don't all fit together. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Anyone ever had this experience? And then you try and go with one of their pre-ordered bowls that they make, and you're like, no, it didn't hit the spot. If you allow me to get a little philosophical for a moment about create your own bowl places, there's an underlying philosophy there that is, I think, quite telling. The underlying philosophy is you can have it all. Everything that you're currently wanting in a moment, you can have all in the same bowl, all in the same meal for just $11.95, right? Or $5.95, or wherever you're going. You can have it all. And I think this is interesting because that's actually, if you really look at our society, like the underlying philosophy of much of Western modern society as well, this promise that you can have it all the things that you want, you can have all together and at the same time. If you just kind of notice, like, on social media and technology and online and movies and TV shows, you notice we're exposed to all these different ideals all at once. We see someone who, you know, has a healthy meal that's prepped every week, and then we see someone who's just killing it on having a consistent sleep schedule, a great morning routine, you know, a jacked body that's ready for swimsuit season, a healthy, thriving, romantic relationship, a home that's clean and stylish, and kids who are cute and mostly obedient, you know, and accomplishments at work, and this consistent morning devotional time with the Lord if they're a Christian, and it looks so picturesque and undistracted, and we're presented with all of these ideals. Like, this is what we're exposed to. And the underlying idea here is that all of these are what you should be aiming for. You should want this and this and this and this and this and this. And man, if you just juggle your life well enough, you should be able to get to this ideal. You can have it all. And for some of us, for many of us, whether currently or at least at some season in our lives, your bank account allows you to live this philosophy as well of saying, man, I want to go on this vacation and I also want to eat out this week and I don't have to choose between the two. That's the reality for many people in our society who are living maybe in the middle upper class. There doesn't need to be a deciding. It's going, I want this, I want this, I want this. I can have it all. You can have it all. When the word priority came into the English language back in the 1400s, did you know that it was only singular? Like, there was no word priorities. It was only priority, and it stayed that way for the next 500 years until the 1900s when we came in and created a second word, priorities. We pluralized the term, and now we start talking about priorities. The word priority meaning the first thing, the one prior thing, the most important thing. The 1900s, we start going, oh, we can have many most important things. Many priorities, all the things that we want, all the things that we think are important, we can have it all. But can we? Can we? In Mark chapter 4, Jesus tells this story about a farmer who is scattering some seed in his field. And he says that as he sowed, some of the seed, it falls among thorns. And it says these thorns, they grew up and choked the plants so that they did not bear grain or bear fruit. So it's literally this image of like a plant that's like starting to grow. And you've never seen a plant starting to grow? I usually don't get there if I try and plant anything, so, you know, genuine question. But apparently, when you plant stuff in the ground, if you tend it well enough, it'll start to grow up, and you'll start to see something. It's this image of a plant that's starting to grow, but alongside it is this thorny vine that is growing just right there. And at some point, before the plant can really get anywhere and start to bear fruit or blossom, these thorny vines literally wrap around it and strangle, like the word is choke, out the life from the vine. And then Jesus said, whoever has ears, let them hear. When he was alone, the 12 and the others around him asked him about the parables. And this is part of what he said. He said, the farmer sows the word, meaning the word of God, but the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful. Now that phrase, the desires for other things, is where we're going to be landing today. And when you look at how that's really phrased and kind of broken down in the original language, it's saying there's desires. When it says for other things, that literally means just like the rest. Like it's translated in other parts of the Gospels as just remaining. Like literally it's everything else. When there's this desire for really everything else, anything else, that these multitude of desires that crowd out our hearts, minds, and souls end up strangling the good growth that God is actually doing and has started in you. I don't know if you've ever felt like when you leave on a Sunday from church or maybe a small group or a Bible study, you're just feeling like motivated. You're like, oh, I actually want to pray. I'm going to stop treating my kids this way. I'm going to finally share about this addiction. I love Jesus. I'm going to spend time with him tomorrow. And then like by the time you get home, you're like, ugh, I have no desire anymore. And I'm irritated with this person, and I'm stressed about my week. You're like, it was just there, like something was starting to grow, and then boom, like something just strangles it out. Jesus is saying that one of the things that will do this is the multitude of desires that we have. Now, does this mean when it says like desires for other things, that this can choke out the growth that God's doing in you? Does this mean that it's bad to want literally to do anything else besides read your Bible and pray? Okay. Is it bad to want some Kelly's ice cream? Is it bad to want to play basketball? Is it bad to want to just hang out with friends? Is it bad to want to watch a TV show? Are these things bad? Is that what he's saying, that all these things are bad things? I don't think that's what he's getting at. See, the word for desires, the desires for other things, is actually the same word that Jesus uses when he says on the Passover meal, when he says, I have eagerly desired to share this meal with you before I suffer. Right? So the word desire, it's not an overtly negative thing. It's really more of a neutral thing. It really depends on how you use it. See, desire is not bad. Desire is not negative. There are some religions and worldviews that will take desire and make it so, but desire is quite neutral. But what you have to know and what you must be aware of is that while desire is not the enemy, it can be a tool of the enemy. We do have a spiritual enemy. And if you're kind of new to church or Christianity, all you're like, this sounds crazy. I know, but it actually makes perfect sense when you look about the world and at our own hearts, why it's so difficult for the good things of God to grow inside of us. We have a spiritual enemy who loves to use desire as one of his tools. So what Jesus is saying here is that when we have many desires, we have to be careful. Because those many desires can steal energy from the one desire that we are made to pursue. This image of like a thorny vine that is growing up alongside a really good plant, like the way that it actually kind of chokes out and literally strangles the other plant is by stealing nutrients from what's supposed to be growing in that good vine. So there's only so many nutrients in the soil, right? There's only so much there. And now when those nutrients are going not just to the good plant, but also to this vine that's growing thorns, all of a sudden there's a way in which the thorny like vine starts to steal the nutrients that would otherwise be going to this growth. When you are trying to grow in God or let God grow something in you, there's a sense in which other desires, the pursuit of other desires, can at times begin to steal energy, time, focus, attention, affection from that which is meant to be directed towards God. And sometimes when we try and chase value all of these different desires, we have this mindset that we can have it all. We can want this, and also Jesus on top of all of this. What ends up happening is we get so spread so thin that we have no passion, energy, or desire to pursue the one whom our souls were made to love. I had a season a couple years ago where I was just really, really struggling with like just juggling everything. And I was like, oh my goodness, I'm struggling to do all of my schoolwork, to do everything for church, to meet up with all the people in my life who I want to catch up with, friends and family, and then to spend time with Jesus and try and be undistracted, and then to also sleep and to also rest and to also work out and also meal prep and to also try and grocery shop and to not let my apartment fall apart. I mean, I was just like, oh my gosh, like there's everything and I'm struggling to balance it all. And I kept using this word balance, you know. I kept feeling like I must have a problem with prioritizing things. And so whenever I had a friend who'd be like, how can I pray for you? I'm like, pray for me to figure out how to prioritize my life. Like, priorities is what I'm really struggling with, you know. I just need to figure out how am I going to balance all of it. And at some point, I was quite convicted because I realized that I didn't have a problem with priorities. It wasn't that I was bad at prioritizing, because I knew the things that I should prioritize that would bring me life. I realized I wasn't bad at prioritizing. I was just resistant to cost. There's a book that I was reading in that season by a kind of leadership business guru and author. His name is Greg McKeown, and he wrote a book called Essentialism. And this is one of the realities that I came to terms with in that season that illuminated not just my practical life and schedule, but my walk with the Lord, and I think is illuminating for us in our walks with the Lord in a similar way. And this is what he said in the book. He said, "It is easy to see why it's so tempting to deny the reality of trade-offs." Okay. After all, by definition, a trade-off involves two things that we want. Do you want more pay or more vacation time? Do you want to finish this next email or to be on time to your next meeting? Do you want to get it done faster or better? Obviously, when faced with the choice between two things that we want, the preferred answer is yes to both. But as much as we'd like, we simply cannot have it all. As economist Thomas Sowell wrote, there are no solutions. There are only trade-offs. There are no solutions. There are only trade-offs. What that means is that for many of us, with the multitude of desires that we have for our lives, and for the world around us, and for our walks with God, we often try and figure out the way to balance all of it, as if we just have to become better jugglers. There's a truth to that. But sometimes, it's not that we just have to figure out how to juggle all the different balls, it's that we need to drop some balls so that we can really focus on the one. It's not that there's a solution that you're looking for, it's that we're resistant to the cost that comes with actually making one thing our priority. We're all resistant to cost because of the culture that we live in that says you can have it all. You can have this, and this. You can desire this, and this. And yes, you can do all of that and also still desire Jesus. But the reality is that for us as human beings, we're unable to juggle all the things that we think we want. And that the gospel actually has a graceful invitation. And let me tell you all, and sometimes we get into Christianity and we don't realize that this is the heart of the gospel, but cost is at the heart of the gospel. The gospel uniquely calls us to a life of costly decisions, of forsaking certain desires so that we can pursue Jesus. In Matthew 13:44, Jesus tells another story, and he compares the kingdom of heaven to a man who is going around and finds this treasure hidden in a field. And it says when he finds this treasure, he hides it again, and then in his joy went and sold all that he has and buys that field. When I read this story, I think, man, the modern Western man or woman would not do what this man did. The modern Western man or woman in our culture would go, oh, I found this treasure in a field. Great, I'm going to buy it alongside my other field too. And now I'll just have this summer vacation home over here, right? And yet he goes, no, no, no. There's something about the treasure in this field that's actually going to require everything. It's going to cost too much. I can't actually keep this going and then also purchase the treasure in this field. Because this treasure, it requires too much from me. It's going to require me to sell this, to actually, there's a cost to this. If I want to pursue this thing, there's going to be a cost. Do you know, have you ever been told, have you been reminded recently that a life of pursuing Jesus will cost you? You cannot have it all. There comes a time where you have to say that my desire for Jesus and for the life that he has, for me and the kingdom he wants to bring in this world, it is better than anything else. And so I'm willing, if it means that I can't do this, if I can't go here, if I can't spend time doing this, if I'm going to use my money this way, it's a worthy cost because it's a treasure that I've found. There is a cost that comes to our desires when we decide we want to desire Jesus above all else. The idea we can have it all is a myth. The reality is that there is always a cost. Even outside of a framework where we're talking about Jesus and spiritual things, we all have orienting desires in our lives at which other desires pay the cost, right? If one of the desires of your life, like an orienting desire of your life, is to really prioritize family, you might also really want to impress your boss at work, and you might also really want the promotion that's going to come if you do, and you might also really want the money that's going to come from that promotion, from you impressing your boss because you're going to stay extra hours. But let's say you have this orienting desire of going, but I really want to prioritize relationships with my family. This is going to take me from that. So therefore, this orienting desire of my life is going to cause a cost to come to these other desires, right? Some of you might get into, you know, this mode sometimes where you're like, I'm gonna turn my whole life around, I'm gonna be healthy. Everything, like I'm gonna work out, I'm gonna have healthy meals, all this stuff, and all of a sudden, like, that starts to cost you, right? Because that's an orienting desire. It means that it's gonna cost you some sleep because you're gonna wake up earlier. It might cost you more money because you're buying things that are a little more expensive. You know, it's gonna cost you because there's this orienting desire that almost like an orbit around which everything else, like, is kind of gravitationally circling. That there's gonna be this one thing that kind of takes the center of our lives. This is just what it means to be human. I think we're made to have some sort of orienting desire around which all of our other desires circle. What the gospel argues is that Jesus is the one who's meant to be that orienting desire. And that in doing so, it doesn't set us up for a life where all the other desires go to die and disappear, but actually that every other desire gets resurrected in a whole new beauty when Jesus is at the center. Psalm 37:4, it says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Saying when you pursue Jesus as the one object of your desire, of going, this is the orienting desire of my life, that in every situation, every decision I'm going to be making, at every point in my day that I remember it, that I'm going to try and turn my heart and my eyes to him, that I'm trying to fill my mind with his words, that I'm going to look at what does it look like in this situation to find my joy in the Lord, and that as we start to make these small little decisions that place Jesus at the center, that every other desire in our life begins to find its proper place and orbit. I remember at some point, my sister and I were going on a vacation to the beach, and I was feeling really stressed as we were leaving because I just really wanted it all to go well, and I wanted to have a good time, and I was trying to think about all the aspects of food and how much time we're going to have to rest and where are we going to stay. I was just like, I just wanted it to be a good time. And as I was walking out the doors, I'm feeling this weird mixture of like excitement and just like anxiousness. I was like, Lord, I don't want to feel anxious about enjoying this time, you know? And I felt so clearly and said, if you make me your top joy, you'll be able to enjoy everything else. Make me your joy, and then you'll be able to enjoy everything else. In other words, delight in me, and you will be able to find joy in everything else. And that's really what happened. I tried to just orient my satisfaction to him rather than trying to enjoy and maximize all the pleasures of the ice cream and the beach and all of it. Those things are all great. I'm not saying they're bad. But as I oriented my heart to the Lord, everything else became more enjoyable. And the pressure was off for those things to be the ultimate thing that gave me satisfaction because I was already satisfied in him. This is the invitation. To go rather than orienting your life around a multitude of other desires, which just pulls us in 1,000 directions, to go, there is one desire, one who is the most desirable, whom my soul was made to chase. And when I put him at the center, everything else falls into place. This is just the reality of what it is to love. Like, when you really love someone or something, like, that desire, it just impacts everything else. And it's not like it's not a burdensome thing. It's a beautiful thing. I was listening to a pastor in New York, Pastor John Tyson. He was talking about seeing his son who's engaged getting ready to be married, like all of the things that they're saying no to because they're trying to like just wait for their wedding day and for marriage. Not just like sexual temptations, but also like they're trying to all get in shape and so they're not eating this and they're not, you know, and then they aren't going out to eat because they're trying to save money. And he said, there's just astounding the amount of no's that you say in that kind of environment for the yes of the person. Man, I'm willing to say no to this because I just am saying yes to this person. I'm willing to say no to this because I'm saying yes to this person. Like, it's such a joy to say no to this because I know how much I love this person and I'm so desiring of relationship and union with them. And that's the invitation. That there are other desires that we say no to, but it's not out of the sense of burdensome or religious guilt. No, that's not it. It's that to be a Christian is to have our hearts captivated with the love of Jesus in such a way that we say no to some of these other desires for the sake of making him the one. When love becomes real, cost just becomes natural. And the more real that love becomes to you, the more natural cost becomes as well. Where I want us to kind of close isn't just by pressing you towards this desire for Jesus. Because as I was really thinking about it this week, I realized that I think it's human nature that desire is not engineered but reflected. That desire is not engineered but reflected.
I was thinking about how my nephew, who's about to be a year old, like, whenever I walk in the room, he's one of those babies that's just good at smiling, so he makes you feel really good about yourself, you know? Like, you didn't even do anything. You didn't make a funny face or anything. He just smiles. It's amazing. And how much joy is, like, stirred in my heart when I see his delight in me. Like, when I walk in the room and I see his face light up, I just, like, I love him all the more. Like, I loved him before that. But then I see him smile and I'm like, oh, like I love you even more than I thought I did. And that is actually the picture of what it looks like to have desire in a relationship with God. 1 John says that he first loved us. I was asked a question earlier this week that just struck me, and I want to ask it to you as well. Not just do you believe that God loves you, but do you believe that God desires you? That you bring delight to God's heart. Not because you've done a ton of things that impress him, not because you've done all the right things, but simply because you're his and he decided to love you. And you can't convince him of anything different. When we start with just trying to make ourselves love God, this can turn into religious obligation and guilt. When we start with the reality that God not just loves, but desires us and delights in us, it initiates a reflection that makes cost so natural and filled with joy. So do you know that he desires you? That you are lovely to him? That you are beautiful to him? That you are compelling to him? That he likes you, not just loves you? Do you believe that? It's interesting because, and I'll invite the band to make their way up as we close here, that parable that Jesus told about a man who found this treasure in a field and then went and sold all that he had to go and buy that treasure. You know, Jesus doesn't tell us who the man is in the parable. Did you notice that? He doesn't say necessarily that we are the man. He doesn't say if it's somebody else. But the point of parables is to jog our imaginations a little bit. And commentators across many years, across many traditions, have interpreted it in two ways of going, I think that story could be about us discovering Jesus, going, he's the treasure that we sell everything for, but also that the reverse is true, that you and I are the treasure in the field that Jesus found and said they are worth sacrificing everything for. Everything that I have, I'm willing to lay aside for the sake of buying that treasure back. You, friends, are the treasure in the field. You are that treasure that he saw you and said, boom, he's worth everything. She is worth everything. And then he went up on the cross and showed it to us so that we would never have any doubt. Do you believe that? As we respond today, we'll have two songs, and I will also want to give you a few opportunities to respond a little more specifically. And one's going to be through communion. And that is, I hope today for you more than ever, a visual representation of the assurance of God's love for you. When those voices enter your head and your heart, and you go, really, me? Is that really true? Like, would he really go that far just for me? As you see the bread that is broken for you and the cup that is extended to you for you to dip the bread in as a symbolic nature, as well as an experiential presence of his love, I pray that you would remember that the answer is yes. And I also want to invite you in the last two songs, if you would like to receive prayer, that there's going to be three of my friends who are in the back. There is just going to be over here today. that would love to pray for you. They're from the prayer team, so they've gone through a training, which basically means that you don't even have to know like what you want prayer for. You can just come up to them like they're ready to receive you. But two particular things that I want to invite you, like if you feel like these two, one of these two things resonates with you today, that I would encourage you to go and receive prayer for. One, if you feel like you need courage for the cost. There is some desire that you feel like is stealing from your ability to desire God. And you recognize that there is going to be a cost to you taking maybe one more step to pursuing Jesus as that one. And you need courage because that cost is hard. That you would come and receive prayer today. And secondly, if you want to know, like with greater confidence, and to feel that God actually desires you, you're like, I know it in my head. Maybe I even felt it before, but like I want to be more confident today that God actually sees and loves and desires and delights in me. Like I want that. Would you bring that to another human being and go, I want that, and let them pray for you? So let me pray for us, and then I'll walk us through the communion elements. If you are helping serve communion, you can make your way up here, and then we'll go ahead and head into the response time. Father God, we are just hothouses of desire, filled with longings for so many things. Some really good things, Lord, some not so good things. Holy Spirit, would you invite us today? Would you invite every single person who's here today to the beauty of what it means to make you our orienting desire? Teach us, God, what it looks like to delight in you. And I pray, God, that you would start today by pouring out your delight on and in us, that we might not just know, but to experience the reality of your love. Come, Holy Spirit, we ask this in your name. Amen. The word says that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, it says that he took bread as he was sitting around with his disciples, and it says that he took bread and he broke it. And he said, this bread is my body broken for you. After supper, he took the cup and he gave it to them and he said, this cup is a new covenant made for you with my shed blood. He said, as often as you do this, remember me. Would you remember him today? Remember his love for you and remember his invitation to you to reflect that love back to him. You can stand and sing. You can come forward for communion. No ushers will lead you, so come just as you feel led. This next time is yours, and gluten-free elements if you need them are on the corners. Let's worship.
So
feelings of my soul pouring me to overflow.
Image of like our hearts being awake, his love being a flame, You know, I just kept getting the image of like when you're trying to carry a candle and the wind is like gonna put it out, so you have to kind of put your hands around it. You know, you cup the flame so that it doesn't go out from all the winds around it. And that's really an image of what we're talking about today, is that as we decide to be people who pursue Jesus as the one above all other desires, that we recognize that there are a multitude of desires that are like wind that could potentially put out that flame, and so we just wanna cup our hands around it so that we're able to walk and take that flame to a world that needs it, amen? So church service has now ended, but church is just beginning. Go and be the church this week and bring that light to those in your families, in your friend groups, and in your workplaces. And if you need to continue receiving prayer, our prayer team will stay back there a few more minutes.